Listening to The Hour of the Time. I'm Pooh.
And I'm William Cooper.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Well, thank you, my dear.
You're welcome.
And let me see. I forgot to do something, didn't I? Let me get this queued up here. We've got something special tonight, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Don't go away, folks. We'll be right back after this very short pause. We'll talk about our special treat. That didn't work too well because I forgot to look down at the bottom of that little thing there and bring this really all the way up to where it's supposed to be. Oops, man, I really goofed on that too. Oh, okay, almost. We almost got it. I can't believe it. Here we go. Oh, boy. Well, we've got somebody here tonight that's going to tell us a lot of neat things. Who is here?
It's Joe.
And who is Joe?
My dad's best friend.
And who else is Joe?
Who else is Joe?
Yeah.
What do you mean?
Well, does he have any children?
Oh, yeah, he does. And I get to play with her sometimes.
And what is her name?
Her name is Catherine.
And does he have a wife?
Yeah.
Does he have a dog?
Mm-hmm.
That's very important, huh?
Yeah.
Good people have to have a good dog, right?
Mm-hmm.
And what else?
Well, he's a carpenter, right?
Yeah, that's right. That's very good.
And he's a builder.
Yes.
And he can build wood.
Yeah, he's a real craftsman.
Yeah, and he works the whole day, but he sometimes, when it's lunchtime, he eats lunch, and then when it's dinner time, he eats dinner time.
Very good. You want to welcome Joe to the Hour of the Time?
Mm-hmm. Welcome Joe to the Hour of the Time.
Thank you. Joe's sitting over here petrified, folks. He's so nervous. He doesn't hardly know what to do. We're going to talk tonight about a lot of things. But first, you know, I remember when John was on the show last, and we talked about my new 45. Remember that?
Yeah.
You were with us when we went out and test fired it.
Mm-hmm.
And I said that I had, with one shot, never having done it before, not thinking that I actually could, took a bead on a rock at 115 yards and hit it just a couple inches below dead center. You were there, weren't you?
Yeah, I witnessed the whole thing. It was amazing.
And that really happened, didn't it?
Yes, it did.
Well, I got some letters that challenged that. They didn't think it happened. But you actually were there.
Yes, I saw it. I saw it. I didn't believe it myself.
Well, it amazed me, I got to tell you. Joe, what are we going to talk about tonight?
Well, we talked earlier about the housing industry in general, ways that people can get a good home. I'm sorry, folks, I'm not a radio personality. I'm a carpenter by trade. Anyway, we've been discussing about how things are built, and being that a home is the major investment in a person's life, second to a car, or first to a car, people look over a car pretty close. They take it for a test drive. They ask questions. But it seems to me that home...
That terrible noise you just heard was Pooh trying to pull her little chair out of the studio past the microphone that Joe is using and scraping it all the way. You got to hold that cord off the mic stand,
okay?
Otherwise it makes a hellacious noise too.
I see.
Okay, I invited Joe on the broadcast, folks, because he's a real craftsman. He's a carpenter of the old style. He knows what he's doing. And in the many conversations I've had with Joe, he has just blown my mind with what happens when homes are being built and shortcuts that are taken in order to save money and how fast they're cranking out houses and those kinds of things. So what we're going to do is we're going to talk a little bit about what Joe knows about houses and what you should know. And I can guarantee you most of you don't unless you're in the housing business. And I mean the housing construction business, right in there doing the construction. You probably don't know much of what you're going to hear tonight. And as most first-time radio guests do, Joe will get over his nervousness and just smooth right in here, and everything will flow real well. And then we'll take some calls, and you guys can ask Joe some questions, and you'll find out that he has a wealth of knowledge. It's just absolutely tremendous. Not only that, but he's a hell of a good shot. He's a good friend. When he goes to work, he goes to work, and he doesn't go to play. And just one hell of a good guy. Joe, we were talking. Most people, when they go out looking for a home, they go to homes that have already been built.
Yeah, they'll go look at the models. They'll have two or three floor plans and a model set up with the furnishings in them. and they'll be all fixed up with the landscaping and everything.
And these are usually homes for tract areas where they built a whole bunch of houses based upon three or four different floor plans, and they just crank these things out one right after another. And they all look really nice, don't they?
Yeah, they have a kind of a Hollywood appearance.
And what do you mean by Hollywood?
Well, they look nice on the outside, but on the inside it's really a different story.
Why don't we talk about that? You know, some of the things that you told me that really floored me, I think people out there need to hear. You talked about going to work on these projects, and why don't you just talk about that? What happens when they're building these tract homes? What do they do first?
Well, let's say, for example, the valley down in Phoenix. It's hot and dry. The cement workers don't want to work the cement too much. So they add a lot of water. And it's smooth and it's easy to work, but you lose all your strength. They pour it in the morning, and that afternoon we're on the floor with tennis shoes, so we don't leave marks or footprints, snapping lines and getting ready to play it out. And then the next following day we start the framing, the exterior frame.
And you're doing this before the foundation has even dried or even begun to cure.
Correct. Your concrete will test out, supposedly, in 27 days, reach minimum strength.
So really nothing should be placed upon that concrete. No building should be done on it for that period of time.
No, not really. But like a lot of the big outfits down there, they build 300, 400, 600 units a year. And it's a production line. It's like very similar to building a car.
So what you're saying then is that pouring this concrete that's got way too much water in it because of the heat there especially, but they do this in other places, and enables them to work with that concrete much quicker than they would if it were the proper consistency and didn't have all that water. And then within 2 hours of pouring the concrete, they're actually laying out the rest of the structure on that concrete, and they're beginning to build, what, walls?
Well, you lay out all your plates, all your interior partitions and all the exterior walls, and your top plate and bottom plate, and then the following day, you'll start framing.
And you'll actually start framing and stacking
construction
on top of this concrete that hasn't even begun to dry, much less cure, yeah. And it never will, because of this, reach anywhere near the strength that it's supposed to be and that the buyer actually believes that it is. Is that correct?
That's correct. That's correct. If it's not covered for 7 days, it'll lose about 50% of its strength.
And they don't cover it at all.
No. No, you can't cover it because we're busy framing on it.
Now, what happens when you're framing, you're building, you're putting weight on concrete that has not dried and has not cured and is supposed to be actually the foundation for the building? Does this mean that in places where there is heavy weight applied, versus places where there's not heavy weight applied, you're going to get a sinking or an uneven foundation?
Yeah, it can, depending a lot on the soil conditions, but it can disrupt the integrity of the structure, the entire structure. And to me, being a carpenter, the whole house is based on the foundation. If you've got a good foundation, you'll have a pretty good house. If you don't have a good foundation, it doesn't matter what you build on it.
So when somebody actually buys one of these tract homes that have been built like this in a hurry, and we're not just talking down in the valley, we're talking all across this country this is going on, because that's how they make money real quick and get a return on their investment, is by building these houses really fast, saving as much on materials and work and labor as they can, and then selling it.
Yeah, but they figure almost 30% just waste.
And if they did it properly, they would have how much waste?
Oh, down around 10-15%.
Okay.
Would be acceptable.
But when people are buying these homes, they think that they're buying a beautiful home that was made properly, has a strong foundation, and in fact they're told all of this. And the truth is that it's not at all.
No. The contractor itself, and usually the home builders, the big builders, they're only on the hook for a year. they guarantee it for a year. They just have to stand behind it.
Uh-huh.
After that, some of the outfits, well, they'll give you a 5-year, 10-year warranty on the foundation or some kind of a extended warranty on certain items. But after that, you know, you're gonna pay for this house for 30 years.
Uh-huh. And, well, I've known people who have bought these homes they're so proud of it, and they invite you over, and you go in and you look. And, of course, you know, until I started talking to you, I didn't know all these things either. And I don't think anybody does. But everything was nice. All the door jams fit, and the walls were, you know, right, and there was no cracks anywhere, and everything worked. And within just a matter of weeks, things started to go wrong. All of a sudden, doors didn't close right. Cracks would appear in walls. And all kinds of things. Floors weren't level anymore. And is this because of the quickie way that they're building these houses now?
Yeah.
Or is it because of shoddy workmanship or bad planning or what?
It's a combination of all those things. You see, the developers, they're profit motivated, but they don't build the house. They subcontract.
Uh-huh.
They have a contractor who subs out portions of the work, and usually the sub will sub out. So you've got a variety of people working on these projects. Some of them are skilled and some of them aren't. So it's kind of a luck of the draw. If you get a good carpenter that builds you a pretty nice house, you're lucky. If you get a bad one, you're not. Same way with the heating or the mechanical or the cement work. You got to remember, these guys they're working by piecework, time.
Uh-huh.
It's not, I get X amount of dollars for quality product. I get X amount of dollars, period. If it takes me a week or it takes me a month, I get so much money and that's it. So the incentive is not to hang around and do a good job. The incentive is get it done and get paid.
Mm-hmm.
And jump on to the next one.
And most of the workers don't make any of those decisions. They're just told what to do by whoever they're working for.
They're told to hurry up.
Yeah.
We were slow. And it took us about 4 days to frame a house. Other crews are doing them in 2.5.
Wow. And speaking of framing, I mean, there's a proper way to frame a house so that the house is strong, so that it has good integrity, and so that, you know, when the new owners move in and they look in their little handy-dandy book and it tells them that the framing is, that the framing is 16 inches apart, and he goes to hang a picture, and he measures out 16 inches and drives a nail through the drywall, there's nothing there. Why is that?
That's there again, you get back to the primary motivator is money. And if you're only getting, say you're getting, there's some guys will do it for 80 cents a square foot, and other guys want $1.50 a square foot. Regardless, you've only got, the longer you take, the less money you make.
Uh-huh.
So everybody's kind of pushed into cutting corners, and maybe one nail will hold it instead of three, and you know, just to get by. It really has nothing to do with quality.
So what are some of the ways that they cut corners and save money that ends up really cheating the home buyer, which is really the proper term for it? They come in thinking that they have a home built to certain specifications and a certain strength and standards, and the truth is, if they could just look through those walls, they would see that it's not at all. So why don't we talk about some of those things that people do to cut corners and save money, that ends up costing the homeowner an awful lot down the line.
First thing, they try to get a good designer. They can design a house, but yet still pass the local codes. They'll try to stretch it. They'll stretch that board as far as they can. And then they buy the cheapest lumber they can get. Instead of kiln-dried lumber, which has been dried in the kiln and then surfaced to dimension, they'll buy S-green, what they call S-green, surface green. It's still wet. It's going to bow. It's going to twist. It's going to warp. It's going to warp.
It's going to do all kinds of strange things, and that's why all of a sudden doors won't close right and cracks appear and walls and ceilings and all kinds of things. What else do they do?
Well, you
green lumber is really bad, though.
Yes, it is, but it's cheap.
Yeah.
It's cheaper than kiln dried. Kiln dried is the preferred.
But no smart person would ever build a house out of green lumber.
Well, yeah, that's correct.
Exactly.
Well, you don't know what it's going to do. It may be fine. It may twist, and everything works good for the first year or so, but after everything's seasoned, drying out and cracking and twisting and foundations moving around, the floor's heaving, you're getting cracks in your ceilings, the doors don't work the way they used to. It all boils down to money. It all boils down to saving a dollar. If they can save $100 per unit, if you build 600 units a year, why, that's quite a bit of money.
Yeah.
And they can, they use the cheapest roof they can get by with. They use the cheapest materials they can get by with. The concrete, they water it down a little bit, stretch it a little bit. It's just a combination of things.
So, really, people should not be buying these homes, is really the truth of the matter.
I personally wouldn't.
Well, after what I've learned, I wouldn't either. And after watching you work for quite some time, I mean, I've got a different feel and a different understanding of what carpentry is all about and the way things should be done. And watching somebody do something that really knows how to do it is quite an experience versus watching a bunch of yahoos who are just in a hurry to make a buck and then go get a quick beer, at the end of the day.
That's basically it. Everybody's trying to make a dollar. Everybody's trying to make a living, but yet at the same time, there's this tremendous pressure to hurry. A normal track home, they'll have it from the time they break ground, it'll take 28 days, and it's done. The people are moving in, they roll out the sod, and they're digging the pool and on the 29th day. And the paint's not even dry, the concrete's not even cured, the lumber's still green. There are certain things as you get experience, you can pick up speed to a certain degree.
Mm-hmm.
But then they've taken it to it's almost ridiculous. There isn't really no time to do anything right. It's just, when can you get it done?
What are some of the other things that they do in the building trade to save money?
Well, they'll cut down on insulation. They'll cut corners wherever they can. They buy cheaper knobs. They buy doors that don't have two hinges instead of three. They'll cut corners anywhere they can. And then also they try to keep the price down on the subcontractors each year. Instead of getting better, why the price goes a little cheaper this year? We're building them pretty cheap,
Is it possible for someone to buy a lot and build their own house and have it financed and have it built better and cheaper than what these people are doing?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, you could. The problem is that most people don't want to take the time. It's pretty intensive. It's time consuming. You got to do your homework. You got to do your research. You got plan check. You got architects to deal with. You got design problems and your procurement of materials. It's an all-day job, and for someone that didn't have the time, it wouldn't work out.
Is it possible for someone who doesn't have the time to contract that house to be built and still get it built the way that it should be instead of the way that most of them are?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I would say instead of buying a track home or something, I'd buy something that maybe a smaller outfit or a small company is building a speculation home. When they're building a speculation home, that means that they're putting the house together in the hopes it'll sell. So they're gonna take a little more time. They're gonna add a few more amenities, a little better grade of carpet, a little better roof. I think it's a better bargain. The ideal thing would be for the person to design his own home and seek out a qualified personnel, whether it be a mason or whether it be a carpenter, or whether it be a roofer, get people that have a reputation, that have a track record of doing quality work.
Uh-huh. How would somebody know who does quality work? I mean, they've all got licenses. That doesn't mean anything.
That doesn't necessarily mean you're going to get quality work.
Yeah. How does someone find real craftsmen? How does someone go out and find people like yourself who really do good work and who really do care? And don't try to cut those corners and cheat the buyer or the builder or whoever they happen to be working for. How do you find those people?
That's kind of a tough question. It's like trying to find a good auto mechanic or a good doctor or a good lawyer. More word of mouth, you have to do your homework. You have to go around some of the better places and ask around who's good. Ask the building inspectors. They know who the good guys are and who aren't, who does the quality work.
So you think the building inspectors would tell you the truth?
Yeah, they would.
Steer you to the right people?
I imagine in these smaller areas, I don't know what they do in the big city.
Yeah. Well, you hear these stories, and I've had people tell me to my face that, you know, they make these little payoffs all the time, and they get all the work steered to them.
Well, that happens too. That's part of the bad name and bad reputation of contractors.
Uh-huh.
The bad make it hard on the good guys.
Now, we also know that people get involved in projects themselves. Like somebody might want to build a, divide a room in half, you know, whatever they want to do. And they're going to do it themselves, and they go out and they buy the Reader Digest book and all these kinds of things, and they watch, what's his name on this old house? Who is that?
Bob Vila.
Bob Vila.
Mm-hmm.
And, but there's somebody better than him. There's a couple who a man and a woman who have a show. I forget the name of the show, and I forget their name, but they actually show you how to do all that stuff, and they do a pretty good job of it.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever watched their program?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's interesting. I think people could do it if you're a little bit mechanically inclined. You don't have to be an athlete or anything. You got to have proper tools. That helps. If you don't get in a big hurry, and take your time and do your research. There's a lot of things in the library. You can get books on carpentry, or you can get, now they've got videos out. Hire an old retired carpenter or something to show you a few tricks, and you know.
Uh-huh. But what are some tips for people who want to do that? I mean, how do they know what kind of lumber to look for? Like, you showed me some things that I would never look for. If I went down to buy some 2x4s, I'd tell the guy what a 22x4s. He'd probably load up the junkiest stuff he had in my trailer, and I'd go rolling off thinking everything was okay. But how do you know if you're getting good lumber? And if you're getting good lumber, how do you know if you've got the good pieces of that good lumber? What are the things that people need to look for?
That's taken me years. You see, there's a certain, they grade lumber. There's an industry standard, supposedly, Western Wood Products.
Yeah, you amaze me today. You're picking up one piece of wood and another piece of wood, and you're showing me the difference between the two, and one of them is used for this, and another one's used for that, and one's no good,
mm-hmm.
and the other one's got rounded corners, and the other one has square corners, and you got to use it for this, this, and this. And I look at it, all looks the same to me. So fill us in here, Jeff.
Well, if you got about 25 years, I guess you can figure out which board to put where. You have to work your material. It's like anything, working leather or working metal or working any kind of a craft. You get to learn your medium, your material, what goes where. Anything structural, I would recommend use Douglas fir, because it's the resinous wood. If you're into lighter stuff, little partitions, you can use hemfer or pine studs. Depends on geographically where you're located.
Why do you recommend Douglas fir for building?
Strongest. It's resinous. It's the best. It's structurally, it's the strongest.
Uh-huh.
West Coast fir.
When you're looking at wood, you showed me some things that you like for framing to make sure that that all the corners are there on the wood and that they're not rounded off and because you're gonna be building walls, you want them to be square and true and all that kind of stuff. And if you don't have straight 2x4s to build a framing that have really good corners on them, then your wall is going to reflect that.
Yeah, you'll have a crooked house.
Yeah, a crooked house.
Crooked like wood, you'll have a crooked house.
Crooked little man with a crooked little house.
That's right. That's right.
Who paid the crooked little carpenter who built the crooked little house.
But over the years, I've seen it deteriorate, the lumber materials. From the old, they've gone from... I don't know where it's going or where, whether we're running out of timber, which I doubt, but each year the grade gets a little worse. They allow more knots at the same grade as before. It costs more. I can't figure it out. I don't know what's going on, but I have to work with it.
Well, you know, that's happening all across the board with all different kinds of materials, not just lumber, but with everything, and with food, too. Same thing with food. Remember when you used to go to the grocery store and get prime beef?
Yeah.
Well, you can't get prime beef now. And remember what used to be labeled as good is now choice?
Mm-hmm.
And the one that was below good is now good. And this is happening everywhere. And it's happening with everything. And I don't really know why either, but I know that it certainly is. There were some other things that you wanted to talk about tonight and share with our listening audience, but while you're thinking about that, we're going to take a break. Don't go away, folks. We'll be right back. And, you should be listening to this broadcast if you're thinking about buying a home or if you have a home already and you really don't know what kind of construction went into it. We come back. We're going to talk about some things. We're going to talk about how you can tell. Joseph, questions if you want, because you're probably out there thinking of questions that I'd never think of in 100 years. Oh, wouldn't it be nice if you just walk out your door and open up this thing in the ground and jump down in there with those little dwarfs and come up with a big wheelbarrow full of diamonds? I know I'd like to do that, just because, for one thing, it'd be a lot of fun. Number two, you'd be able to do some things you couldn't do before because you didn't have the diamonds to do it with. And, those things are quite beautiful to look at. But we can't do that, folks. We have to go out and make a living. And we have to do it in the best way that we can, each of us according to his knowledge and talents. And isn't it strange that the more we do that and the more we work and the harder we toil to get something for ourselves and for our family, all of a sudden something happens and it just sort of sifts through your fingers and kind of disappears. And you just don't seem to be making as much as you used to make. The truth is, you're making the same amount of money, in most cases more. But you can't buy as much with it because it's always, continually, and forever losing its value, which means the price of everything goes up. Some of you can even remember when only one person in the family had to work to support the whole family pretty well, by golly. And now you can't do that anymore. Well, folks, if you want to protect at least a portion of your assets from that constant nibbling and dwindling and disappearing into thin air, you need to get your hands on some real money. Gold and silver coin, or bullion, or platinum, or any of these precious metals that don't ever lose their value. Traditionally, it's been gold and silver that has been the mark, the measure by which all economies and all markets have been measured, and that is true even today, ladies and gentlemen. If you don't believe me, turn on your television and wait for the financial report, and you'll see that the big news of the day is the price of gold and silver every single day. And the clothes is also important. So you need to call Swiss America Trading and talk to Frank, talk to any of the good people there. Get your hands on some real money, real money. You'll be amazed. You'll be amazed when you get your hands on a silver dollar
or a gold coin in any denomination, I don't care, I like to say $20 gold piece, hold $20 bill in your left hand and a $20 gold piece in your right. Tell me which one has worth. Oh, that's quick. Boy, realization comes to people's eyes so fast when you perform that little simple test. 1-800-289-2646. Do it now, ladies and gentlemen. You'll be so glad that you did. You will be amazed at how good you feel when you have some of this stuff stashed away. And you know that if everything comes tumbling down around your ears, everybody else will be running around trying to spend their paper money, and they won't be able to do it. You'll be okay. 1-800-289-2646. Don't go away. Be right back with Joe the Carpenter. Welcome back, Joe. The whistling in that song was courtesy of who? Well, Joe, let's talk a little bit about, and then we'll take some calls. How does someone know if they've got some problems with their house that can be corrected either by them or by somebody who knows what to do, and add a lot of strength and years to their house and probably some value while they're at it? Without, you know, tearing the whole place apart and rebuilding it from the ground up, what can they do?
Well, I would suggest that the first thing is don't buy a bad house.
Well, of course.
But it's like you can get a lemon in a car and you can get a lemon in a house, only the house is going to be a lot more expensive than the car.
And a lot harder to sell if it's obviously a lemon.
But people need to do, for this kind of investment, people need to be more educated, and they need to do their homework. They need to find out whether the outfit that they're buying, the company that they're buying their home from, is got a good track record. Go ask somebody that lives in one of their houses. Walk up to the door and knock on the door and say, how do you like this? Do you like the home? Do you have any problems with it? You hear stories of people being in the house like a year, and all of a sudden the big cracks in the roof, and cracks in the corners of the walls, and like you said, the doors stick, and things don't work as well as they used to.
That's because that green wood is drying out. Yeah, it's all warping and going crazy. Not only that, it warps and goes crazy much worse than it would because the framing isn't done properly.
Right.
Instead of putting framing at 16 inches apart, they go to like 2 feet. Does anybody go more than 2 feet?
No.
But they're
not allowed.
They'll go as wide as 2 feet, and instead of putting two or three nails wherever they're needed, they may only put one. And of course, you know, there's no structural integrity there.
Well, take, for example, a typical...
By the way, folks, I learned all this from Joe today. I don't know anything about it.
pick your just your basic track home, what we call custom tracks. Anyway, you've got a 2x4 wall. Inside you have a half inch of drywall, gypsum board. Outside you have a half inch of rigid styrofoam and a half inch of stucco.
And that's it?
That's your wall.
What about insulation?
Well, yeah, you'd have R11 insulation, 3.5 inches of insulation.
Uh-huh.
But that doesn't do anything structurally for you.
And that's it. You really got drywall and styrofoam.
And covered with, hopefully, a half inch of stucco.
Wow. Now, that's incredible. That really is incredible.
We should call them the hollow houses. We could knock on them.
I do know a little bit about houses, how houses used to be built. Back in the days when people took pride and understood that a home was supposed to last for an awful long time. And that's why you have frame homes and these old Victorian homes still standing today that were built well over 100 years ago.
In the Midwest, like what we used to call not the brownstones, but they were graystones. They had the big porch, the big massive porch. And they were beautiful homes with built-ins. And that was an era that's gone. Before the Second World War, my homes were pretty well built by individuals that knew what they were doing. They were craftsmen. They weren't in a hurry.
Uh-huh.
It might take them a year to build a house. But after the war, a guy by the name, I don't remember his first name, his name was Levitt. He got the idea that he could build homes like people build cars. You'd have a framing crew come in, and you have a sheeting crew come in. You have everybody specialized. Everybody's doing their piecework, and it was like an assembly line. They could save money, but yet you didn't get the quality. You didn't get that craftsmanship because it was after the war, all the soldiers came home and they got married and they had kids and there weren't any places to rent. There was a housing shortage.
Yeah.
So and it's taken off from there to what it is today. Like I say, they crank a house out in 28 days, and I'm sure that there's outfits a little quicker than that.
Yeah. Well, back in the old days, they used to buy all the materials that were going to go into a house. They would dig the foundation. They would lay the foundation either with stone or with concrete or however they were going to do it. And then they would let it cure and set and reach its maximum strength. And then they would pile all of the lumber and the window frames and everything that they had, the trusses, everything, on top of that foundation after it had cured and reached its maximum strength. And they would cover it and let it sit for an entire year. And that was so that if the foundation was going to shift or settle, it would do so because it would have the weight of all the material, even the nails, they would pile on top of this foundation. And after that year was over, they would take all the stuff off, and they would re-measure and take the level of the foundation, and if there was anything wrong, if it had settled, then they would fix it right then, and then and only then would they build the house. And so they had some tremendously solid and sound foundations, and they built really good homes, and that lumber had sat there and cured for a whole year and dried right there on the spot where it was going to become a home, so it adapted and acclimated to the weather and all of that stuff. And they don't do any of that now.
No, nothing. That would be, you'd have to do that yourself. You'd have to be an owner builder or hire someone special to do that for you.
Uh-huh.
Now, like I say, nowadays they're cranking them out in 28 days.
You want to take some calls?
Yeah, let's take some calls.
Okay, well, the number is 520-333-4578. If you'd like to call and ask Joe a question about carpentry or homes or, you know, something about your house, how to fix it if you have a problem, or any of those kinds of things while he's here, take advantage of it because he has a tremendous wealth of knowledge. I don't know anything about it, and so probably I'm not asking the right questions tonight, and Joe, being his first time on radio, is a little bit petrified over here. You ought to see his ears are glowing redder than Rudolph's nose, and I'm not trying to embarrass him, but get a little humor into this. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bob. Bill, hi, Joe. This is Grayson, Wisconsin. Hey, Joe, I don't know if you can hear me. I can't hear you through here. I've got a house here, and I'm wondering what type of insulation board to put on the exterior, adding to an existing 3.5-inch wall, because it's cold up here in Wisconsin, obviously. And they're recommending our board, 1-inch with the R rating of 8. Is that going to pay off in the future for such a minimal amount of insulation?
You're talking about a rigid, like a polystyrene?
That's correct, yes. And they recommended against the aluminum foil there, because they said sometimes
that it has a aluminum backing front and back.
Yeah, they recommend against that with the vinyl siding, though. They said it interacts with the siding. So they're going just with the plain, what they call R board, without the metal foil.
What would you recommend, Joe? Well, now you're going to have, you have existing siding, and you're going to put the R board, as they call it, over that, and then you're going to go vinyl siding over the R board.
Yeah, they're going to pull the masonite siding off, and then they're going to put the R board on, put the masonite siding on flush to add a backing for the vinyl so it looks smooth.
Yeah.
And we're wondering, I'm wondering if that's, worth the effort for only an R factor of 8.
Well, I tell you, you'll get a little more than that out of it. Plus, being where you're at, it's cold, and it gets cold here. And I did the same similar thing to my house. My pipes used to freeze inside the walls. It's an older house.
Uh-huh.
And I put some of that stuff on there, and it quit doing that altogether. It made it much more comfortable. It makes it quieter. It gives you some sound attenuation. It also gives you insulation and vapor barrier. It's pretty hard to beat that stuff. As an after product.
So you think that the 1-inch would, even though it's a lower value, would probably give you a little bit better long-term or after the installation then?
Well, you've got a 3.5-inch wall now, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that's just more between you and the weather.
One person said get this 2.5-inch stuff and for $25 a sheet, but it'd take you almost 25 years for that to pay for itself.
Yeah. That's right. I don't think I'd go any thicker than 1-inch, because you get into the real thick 2.5-inch, 2-inch way, it's hard to fasten it, and it's hard to fasten anything on top of that and get it to hold.
Yeah.
Your nails are getting extremely long.
Well, okay, I won't keep you, fellas. Thank you, Joe and Bill. I just picked you up here. I'm starting in on the shortwave stuff, and I think out of all of them, you're the one. And I appreciate what you're putting out there. And what I would suggest, I'd like to order some stuff, and I'm sure some of the people would like to order some of your material there, but we don't have too much, time on the advertising thing.
Well, that's because this broadcast it's not a salesman show. I'm not trying to sell you anything.
But you're good, and you've got good ideas, and you're sound what you say, and the literature that you would support from what you write or contribute via your broadcast would be, everybody would, a lot of people I'm sure would enjoy ordering, or like you said, it's not a salesmanship, but I myself would like to see what you have available, just seed for thought.
Well, maybe we'll talk about some of that stuff tomorrow night.
Yeah, okay. Well, thank you for your time, fellas.
Thank you. And it's not just that board is of less value, because it's cumulative. He's
right.
Adding it over 3.5 inches of insulation already, which means that instead of going down like he obviously thought, he's actually increasing the R rating.
Oh, yeah. He's increasing his resistance to heat transfer.
Yeah.
That's what you're after. And I think what he's talking about is going to be money well spent in the long run.
Okay. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah, good evening. This is Lynn in North Carolina. I got a question for Joe.
Uh-huh. Go ahead.
I just had a cement pad poured about a 27. To be made into a carport, maybe later on enclosed into a garage. And it's at least 5 or 6 inches thick at the minimum. I'm getting a hairline crack. This is about 30 days old now. Getting a hairline crack starting across the width. of this cement pad. It's a real, real fine crack, and it doesn't go all the way from side to side. Stops about halfway.
Well, I'll tell you what the three things that concrete's guaranteed to do,
mm-hmm.
and it's guaranteed to get hard, turn white, and crack.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the way it sounds. If as long as it stays a small crack, a hairline crack, see, it has to move. It has to crack. It has to crack somewhere. It has to relieve the tension.
Mm-hmm. And the bigger the slab. I do know a little bit about concrete. The bigger the slab that's poured, the more it's going to crack because it doesn't have anything to work against except itself. That's why you have sidewalks poured in small squares with that expanding material that used to be tar. I don't know what they use today between the cracks, so that as the concrete expanded, it would this tar would give way. Sometimes you would even see those crack, but they're not as prone to crack as a larger slab.
Now, did they put expansion joints, strikeout expansion joint in there?
Had driveway done too. It's about $5,000 worth of work. All it was done in two different stages. They poured the mm-hmm. head for the garage first, and then it cured out about 2 weeks before it parked any vehicles on it.
Mm-hmm.
And they poured the driveway up to the slab.
Mm-hmm.
So they had about 2 weeks curing time before we got to park anything on him. They said you could drive on your driveway after 3 days.
How many days?
Yeah, after 3 days.
No.
I give
it. Yeah, I would wait a little. You should cover it. They should have covered it for 7 days, kept it moist.
Well, down here in the South, they don't cover anything. I watched a lot of places for.
Yeah, well, see, you'll lose 50% of your strength by not covering it.
If it rains and it's still wet, they'll cover it or something like that. But
concrete continues to get hard. 50 years from now, it's continuing to get hard.
Mm-hmm.
It's not just water drying in this goo that you poured. There's a chemical reaction
right.
that takes place.
Yeah, I understand. Mm-hmm. They put, as far as expansion joints, they put metal expansion joints out in the driveway part, but the slab is just a big square like you were talking about, a rectangle.
Mm.
There's no expansion joints in it at all that I know of.
Normally what they'll do, at 12 feet or 15 foot intervals, they'll strike a joint, not all the way through, just make a groove,
mm-hmm.
and that allows a place for it to crack.
Mm-hmm.
It's under stress.
Right.
And as long as it stays a small hairline crack, I don't think you're going to have any problem. Did they have any wire mesh or reinforcement in the concrete?
There's no rebar or anything in it. As a matter of fact, I hadn't even called him. It just happened a couple of days ago that I noticed it. And you know, it's barely get your fingernail in it. And I thought I'd give him a call and see what his opinion was on it.
Yeah. Well, if it gets any bigger, I'd say you'd have some recourse. But if it's just a small crack, you're going to see that in any kind of concrete work you do. Sooner or later, somewhere it's going to crack.
Just normal. Okay, well, have me word. I appreciate that.
Will you see one, Joe, that goes all the way across the whole slab? I mean, that's what he's talking about. Even if it's a hairline crack, I mean, that's a pretty big crack.
Yeah, it's an indication that it's relieving stress.
Can it be sealed?
I guess it could. I mean, it's not necessarily cracked all the way through, I don't think. This has been whirly-birded and, you know, slicked on the top.
Okay, they might have.
That's what I'm seeing cracked, is that very thin layer on the top.
Mm-hmm. Well, a lot of times, sometimes if you work cement too much, if you finish it, work it too much, you draw up too much of the fines, you draw up too much of the cement out of there, and you get, like, what they call eggshell cracks. You get little
that's what it looks like.
Yeah, like little eggshell cracks. So I wouldn't worry about that. That's just a surface thing.
Yeah, this is just in a pretty much a straight line. You know,
mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, I appreciate the information, and I want to tell Bill, I'm an avid listener of this show. I've been listening to you, Bill, for probably about 3 years now. So keep up the good work.
Thank you.
All right. Bye-bye.
And thank you for your call. 520-333-4578 is the number. Yeah, I thought he was talking about a crack through the main slab, but he was talking about that small layer that they put over the top to finish it out and make it look nice and smooth and beautiful. No, I get that on my back. That's nothing. Good evening. You're on the air.
Yeah. Hello.
Hello.
Yeah, Joe. It's a good program. Listen, I was in the, I live in Dallas, outside of Dallas, Texas, and I was in construction for well over 20 years. I agree with everything you say. I've seen it all, literally. And you said the right thing about people finding, checking around, finding the right people. And another thing is if you're having a house built or you've picked one out, go out there every day as often as you can. Look at the concrete. Look at the framing. Look at the wood. Make sure it's being done right. And really look at it, because I've seen the quality around here just go down the tube.
You know, that reminds me of something. If you go and you pick out a lot and you've already bought the house before they build it, you have the right then. If you've already paid for it, you have the right to go to that construction site and supervise the building of that house.
Oh, yeah. And, you know, we used to like it, man. I mean, you know, some of these guys would come out and, you know, they'd bring you pizza and drinks and stuff. And
smart people.
Yeah. And, well, there's a lot of folks around here, man. I mean, you know, well, there's a lot of sloppy stuff I see around here. You know, siding and interior, it just comes apart real quick. It's incredible that most people don't know what to look for. If they just do a little research and spend a little time, but they're spending a lot of money over a lot of years, and it's gonna, you know, it pays off to spend a little time and catch it right from the start, especially with that concrete. Oh, Lord. You know, it gets real hot here, and they pour the concrete. They never covered it, and every now and then you'd see them walk around like on a sidewalk or something, and they'd be spraying kerosene or something on it, kind of a semi-cover, kind of try to seal it, or they'd use kind of a paraffin-based sealant on the concrete. I used to snap lines a lot. I did that for years. We'd snap lines on these big jobs, and we'd get on it right after they poured it while it was still sort of wet.
Yep.
And then they'd just start dumping the material on it and go right after it the next day.
Mm-hmm.
And they'd shorten the concrete a little bit too, so the bottom plate didn't necessarily sit all the way on the wall either. It'd be leaning over. And yeah, they'd cut a little bit of concrete here and there, quarter inch, half inch here and there. That added up too.
Oh, yeah.
And
are you guys trying to tell me that a lot of these people who bought $200,000 homes really only have $25,000 homes?
Sure. Absolutely. I mean, this
He's right.
is true real quick. And you'd see these real nice homes that have that cheap Masonite siding on it, you know. And here in Texas, I mean, man, it's blazing hot. And it'd get wet. And they use this yellow pine studs for framing. Man, it'd rain and the sun would come out and hit that stuff and it'd look like spaghetti.
Yeah. Wow.
They keep right on using it, man. And I did a lot of punch out on that stuff. We'd go in, straighten the studs out in the wall, and my goodness, you could go in there after they had already sheetrocked and textured it, painted it. Oh, it looked awful. But then I had the eye to catch it. I could see that. I was, boy, this looks awful. And these people were going in there in these developments and these areas where they were building these nice homes, and man, they really thought they were living good. You know, they were better than everybody else. They were new part of town where all the rich folks live. But well, I'll tell you what, within a year that siding would start warping and the trim face part would start coming loose, and oh, it just really looked shabby.
You know, I hate to do this, but I got to cut this off because we're out of time.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Don't be sorry. I wish I could let you talk some more because, you know, the reason I did this broadcast tonight is because the biggest investment anybody ever makes is their home.
Mm-hmm.
And not only that, their home is a great part of the American dream. And I hate it. I can't stand it that people are being cheated and taken on these homes like they are today. It is horrible. But anyway, we're out of time, so I want to thank you for your call, and Joe, I want to thank you for being our guest, and we're going to have you back, and next time we're just going to take calls because, you know, just like I said a while ago, these people, they know what to ask because they're having the problems, and I think that's what we need to do. So maybe you can come back next week, and we'll just have a program where we just take calls and let the callers talk to you and ask their questions, and you can answer, and we can make comments or... you know, whatever we need to do. So, thank you.
Thank you.
And good night, folks. God bless each and every single one of you.